Today we're going to be talking about the most important words ever written in the English language. Some might consider this to be a rather contentious or subjective issue. I mean, just consider how many words have been written in English throughout hundreds of years that language has been prevalent in the world. There have been countless poets and authors and playwrights and indeed philosophers, world leaders. There have been tremendous expositions and tremendous expressions in the English language for hundreds of years. But the words we are going to be talking about today have been quoted and misquoted and used and talked about and alluded to countless times for literally hundreds of years.
To be or not to be. That is the question. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles and by opposing, end them. To die.
By a sleep to say we end the heartache and the thousand natural shocks that flesh is heir to. 'Tis a consummation devoutly to be wished. To die. To sleep.
Sleep. Chance to dream. Aye, there's the rub. For in that sleep of death, what dreams may come when we have shuffled off this mortal coil must give us pause. There's the respect that makes calamity of so long life. For who would bear the whips and scorns of time? The oppressor's wrong, the proud man's contumely, the pangs of disprized love, the law's delay, the insolence of office, and the spurns that patient merit of the unworthy takes, when he himself might his quietus make with a bare bodkin.
Who would fardels bear to grunt and sweat under a weary life, but that the dread of something after death? The undiscovered country from whose bourne no traveler returns puzzles the will and makes us rather bear those ills we have than fly to others that we know not of.
Else, conscience does make cowards of us all. And thus, the native hue of resolution is sicklied o'er with the pale cast of thought, and enterprises of great pith and moment, with this regard their currents turn awry, and lose the name of action.
And lose the name of action.
And lose the name of action.
They are the most famous words ever written by William Shakespeare, by far. These words are, of course, from his play Hamlet, Act III. You probably know them quite well. But do you know what they mean? This is the irony of the to be or not to be speech, is that everybody has heard this speech in one form or another, or at the very least, they have heard to be or not to be, that is the question. But what really is the question being asked? We hear the words, but do we allow those words to penetrate into our heart and to penetrate into our consciousness? Or do we just brush them aside? Or does the ego mind throw its arms up in the air and say, I don't know, I can't understand Shakespeare? Or it's all just gobbledygook, or it's all just poetry, and poetry never makes any sense. You can interpret poetry a million different ways, and so it has no inherent meaning. All meaning is subjective. All meaning is created in the mind of the person listening. But this is not so. This is only true for ego mind. And so if, as modern intellectuals believe, that the only way of knowing is in the brain, in the monkey mind, in ego mind, then yeah, all knowing in ego mind is subjective, and all knowledge is subjective, if you limit yourself to that level of understanding, indeed, to the level of understanding. The word itself gives it away. It is not knowing, it is understanding. It is only thinking we know. What then is really being said or asked when Hamlet says, to be or not to be, that is the question. Whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against a sea of troubles and by opposing end them. To die, to sleep no more, and by sleep to say we end the heartache and the thousand natural shocks that flesh is heir to. 'Tis a consummation devoutly to be wished. We're going to break it up line by line, for indeed, this speech, like scripture, like Rumi's poems, they can be meditated upon, these words. Individually, each phrase, each word can be meditated upon, like the teachings of Master Samael. The question here is, despite all this talk of death and sleep, most contemporaries understand this speech to be about whether Hamlet wants to take his own life, or whether Hamlet thinks it's worthwhile to go on living. To live or not to live? To live or to die? That's the question. Most contemporary intellectuals will interpret this in that way. But this is not what's being discussed here. Not by a long shot. To be or not to be? That is the question. It's there, literally. Hamlet doesn't say, boy, should I kill myself? No. And this is not a poetic way of asking that question. The question is, to be or not to be? Well, what does it mean to be? We are called human beings, not human livings, and we're not human doings, and we're not human sayings. We're not human busies, busy bees. No, we're human beings. That is because we all have our innermost being. And we are not our innermost being. We are not human beings. We are this false self, this ego mind, which suffers the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, and actually wants to take arms against a sea of troubles, and by opposing end them. And Hamlet is telling us this when he says, whether 'tis nobler in the mind to suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, or to take arms against the sea of troubles and by opposing end them. This is what the ego mind wants. The ego mind wants to end its sea of troubles by opposing them. Is that not what we do? Is it not comfort and security that we seek on a regular basis? That is what it means not to be. The mind convinces us that it's nobler to take up arms against the sea of troubles and oppose them and end them. Whereas the being wants us to be, simply be, to be one, to brave the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune, to suffer voluntary suffering, sacrifice for humanity. These are how we clear our karma. Not by running away from our problems, not by opposing the sea of troubles. That's what the ego wants to do, and that's why the ego mind is in opposition to our innermost being. That's why we are not true human beings. We are intellectual animals. We are ego minds. We are monkey minds, trying to create a comfortable and secure life for ourselves, trying to avoid as best we can the sea of troubles. But the irony is that sea of troubles is precisely what we need to experience, what we need to learn from, how we need to be to accept the sea of troubles which comes our way. To be okay with whatever circumstances happen in our life. Or to thrash around in neuroses and I don't like this and I don't want that and I gotta change this and I gotta change that because I need this and I need that and I want this and I want that and we just all we need to do is observe all those voices in our head going crazy to know that that's not being. That's not the voice of our being. That's not the will of our innermost beloved, of our innermost God. So Hamlet goes on, to die, to sleep no more, and by a sleep to say we end the heartache and the thousand natural shocks that flesh is heir to. So here is very interesting because in this discussion of dying and sleep, we face the reality of our sleeping consciousness. We are asleep. And Hamlet explains that. Shakespeare reveals that when he says, to die, to sleep no more. He is telling us right there that death is a way of ending this sleep that we are currently existing. He's not saying to die, to live no more. He says to die, to sleep no more. We are asleep. We are asleep. And it is by death that we can escape this sleep. And to end the heartache and the thousand natural shocks that flesh is heir to die, to end our suffering. It's the goal of awakening, of enlightenment, of all spiritual aspirations, is to end the suffering of all beings. And Hamlet says, 'tis a consummation devoutly to be wished, to die, to sleep. Perchance to dream, aye, there's the rub. For in that sleep of death, what dreams may come, when we have shuffled off this mortal coil, must give us pause. Again, if you just try to read this intellectually, it will make no sense, because the words dying and sleeping are being interchanged here. We're moving from psychological death, to die, to sleep no more, to physical death, where if we die and we sleep perchance to dream, aye, there's the rub, because every time we go to sleep, it's very similar to what happens to us after we die. Are we awake when we die, or do we dream while we dream? What is dreaming? Our bodies, our astral body leaves our physical body, and we travel in the astral plane, but we are not awake. So we're batted around in these dreams like a cat playing with a mouse. We're the mouse, and our subconscious mind bats us around in the lunar astral plane. We don't go to the solar astral plane when we dream. We go to the lunar astral plane. We go to hell. We go to Klipoth. We go into our subconscious mind and we travel there subconsciously. And that's where we dream. And that's depending on how deep we go, whether we have terrible nightmares or we just have, you know, just another mundane repeating what we did during the day over and over and over again mechanically. The mind just mechanically repeating like a machine what it was doing while it was so-called awake. But it was never awake. In its waking hours, it's asleep. That's the point. The consciousness is asleep. So here, Hamlet says, to sleep perchance to dream, aye, there's the rub. For in that sleep of death, what dreams may come when we have shuffled off this mortal coil must give us pause. There's the respect that makes calamity of so long life. For who would bear the whips and scorns of time, the oppressor's wrong, the proud man's contumely, the pangs of despised love, the law's delay, the insolence of office, and the spurns that patient merit of the unworthy takes, when he himself might his quietus make with a bare bodkin, who would these fardels bear, to grunt and sweat under a weary life, but that the dread of something after death, the undiscovered country from whose bourne no traveller returns, puzzles the will, and makes us rather bear those ills we have than fly to others that we know not of. That's a rather long passage, and it doesn't really require us to break us down word by word, step by step here. The point of what Hamlet's saying is that, look, all of this stuff that we go through, all of this suffering in this life, this is just the surface. This is just the tip of the iceberg. When we die, we will dream. We will go into limbo. We will go into hell, into Klipoth. And there, we will face those ills that we know not of. Is it better to bear the karma and the burdens that we know of here in life now, or to flee them, to fly to others, a situation of bearing those sufferings, those ills that we know not of? In other words, the ones in our subconscious mind, the ones that we don't have access to, but that come and haunt us and make us suffer while we sleep, when we dream. Do we continue with the nightmare here now, or do we run away from all of that and subject ourselves to the real nightmare after death? Thus, conscience does make cowards of us all. And thus the native hue of resolution is sicklied o'er with the pale cast of thought, and the enterprises of great pith and moment. With this regard, their currents turn ari and lose the name of action. In that sense, this entire speech, there's a double entendre going on between sleep and death and dreaming. It is not just physical death and physical dreaming, but also psychological death and psychological dreaming. We can be dreaming and suffering while we are awake and alive, and we can also be dying while we are awake and alive. This is why it's so important to read Shakespeare with the heart, with the consciousness, not with the mind, because the mind starts stumbling and tripping over all this stuff. The mind desperately trying to read Shakespeare and figure out Shakespeare. Shakespeare is something you have to feel in your heart. You feel the words. And the meaning arises in your consciousness and the comprehension of these words. To actually try to talk it all out and step by step and make it make sense to the ego mind is practically impossible. We're talking about the highest of poetry here. We're talking about the highest of esoteric wisdom here, expressed in such a beautiful, comprehensive way. Shakespeare is written by the consciousness for the consciousness. It's a faculty higher than the mind. It's a faculty that begins in the sixth dimension. Willpower, telema, the Greeks called it, which is above the fifth. The astral body is the fifth, which is, with the astral plane is the fifth dimension, and it's made up of the astral body, the emotional body, and the mental body. Those combined create the astral plane, but the causal body is above that. It's a more subtle body. And above that is the consciousness. Incidentally, Hamlet is a very esoteric name. Hamlet includes the mantra Ham. If you ever perform the Ham Sa Pranayama, you know that the mantra Ham can be used to draw up the prana through the spinal column on the in-breath. In addition, Hamlet, spelled backwards, is Telma. It's not a big stretch or a big difference between Telema and Telma, which is willpower. Really what it comes down to is Hamlet is, and even in the speech, what he's debating is whether or not he is going to be or not be, whether he's going to align himself through willpower with his innermost being and suffer the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune and be brave, or is he going to allow his conscience to make a coward of him and shuffle off this mortal coil and oppose a sea of troubles and end them? Is he going to continue sleeping and dreaming, or is he going to die and sleep no more, and thereby end the heartache of the thousand natural shocks that flesh is heir to? Flesh is heir to. We are heir to the natural shocks of acute suffering. These are tremendous opportunities for spiritual advancement. They are tremendous opportunities to evoke lasting change in our lives, in our consciousness, how we live our lives, and we are never the same. Once we endure any one of these thousand natural shocks that our flesh is heir to, because that's another aspect that we need to comprehend here, is that flesh is not intended for comfort and security, for leisure, for entertainment, for pleasures. It's fine. It's okay. It's nobody's saying that, you know, you have to, you know, whip yourself like the medieval monks did. That's just ridiculous. But the other extreme is also ridiculous. The idea that we inherited this flesh for the sole purpose of pleasures and entertainments and comfort and security and laziness and gluttony and lust, in between those two extremes is something known as the path of the razor's edge. The ability to enjoy the pleasures of the flesh, but not to an extent that we become identified with them, not to the degree that we become a slave to those pleasures and those entertainments. We can enjoy ourselves, we can enjoy the food we eat, the sex we have, beauty and wonder and all these wonderful things around us, and we can have fun. Of course we can have fun, and we can be in all of that, but then we cross the line. We cross the line into not being, into thinking, into wanting, into thinking about the past and wanting for the future. We're no longer being in the moment. in our gluttony, in our lust, in our pride, in our laziness, in any number of egos, and we no longer be. We sleep, we fall asleep, and we dream, and we suffer. And how do we get out of that suffering? Well, we die, psychologically. We die to that sleep. This is the process of elimination of the ego, the elimination of the false self. This is what the ego fears so much, and this is how conscience, our consciousness, makes cowards of us all. And thus, the native hue of resolution is sicklied over with the pale cast of thought. Thought is not illuminating. Thought is pale, like the moon. The sun doesn't cast light. The moon casts a shadow. The native hue of resolution, this word resolution, is on the right hand of Baphomet, who points upwards with his right hand. And tattooed or inscribed on his right forearm is the word solve. Solve is the root word of resolution, because it is the root word of resolve. To resolve, as in return, as in relegare. Solve is related to the word solvent. A solvent is what you use to dissolve something. Again, there's that word, solve. The irony here is the solution. When we think of a solution, we think of a synergy. We think of a coming together where the solution or the answer comes to us and all the pieces of the puzzle come together to form the answer, and there's the solution. But that's actually not what solution means. Solution is exactly the opposite of that. And that is when something solid is dissolved, is in solution. It means that if you take a sugar cube and put it into water, and you stir it around and you let it dissolve, the sugar becomes in solution. The solution is when the solid thing becomes dissolved into its essence. Resolution, then, means to be in essence, to return to essence, re-solution, to return to solution. And that is why the superior worlds are more subtle and more light. They are less dense. This material, dense aspects of ourselves are broken down and broken up. They are dissolved. And as they are dissolved, we are resolved. Our suffering, our pain, our karma is resolved through that process of living them, of experiencing them, of comprehending them, of extracting from them what's the essence of what we need to know about ourselves, about our mistakes. The essence of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. Not to eat of its fruit, but to comprehend the essence of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. To experience that knowledge in essence. Not crudely and physically, by eating of the tree of knowledge and experiencing that level, that base physical animal level. So people say, well, if you want to understand evil, you have to commit evil. You have to be evil. If you want to understand lust, you have to fornicate. But that's not the essence. That's not a resolution. We're not in solution. We're in it. We're in the dense, hard, heavy. That's why we suffer, because we're stuck in that, the grunt and sweat under a weary life. That's what we are in. But to get out of that, to resolve that, to be in solution, means to dissolve all of that, dissolve who we are. And thus the native hue of resolution is sicklied over with the pale cast of thought. Your head can't figure it out. It makes itself sick over. It makes itself neurotic about, and fearful and anxious and paranoid and angry and depressed. All of those well-known documented behaviors of ego mind. And as a result of that, enterprises of great pith and moment with this regard of their currents turn awry. So the great enterprises, the enterprises of great pith, meaning pithy, meaning real, meaning important, the real nutrition, the real substance, substantive substance of the enterprises in our lives, and the moment, and moment by moment, with this regards, their currents turn awry, they lose their direction and lose the name of action. They lose the name of action. There is so much in that final three words, name of action. It's funny because the speech begins with to be or not to be. That is the question. And here in the end is revealed the name of that force which sets everything in motion. The I am that I am. The holy name of God. Because it is through being that we can know and that we can claim the name of our innermost action. Action is actually a physics term. So, and action is related to light. And we lose the name of action. When we say that, we are supposed to be human beings, not human doings. The ego mind wants to react to that by saying, well, how am I supposed to get stuff done? I have so much to do. I have all these responsibilities. I have so much stuff that I need to do. How am I supposed to get it done if I'm not supposed to be a human doing, if I'm not supposed to do anything? Well, the answer is simple. Be a human being done. Know yourself. Connect. Gain the name of action inside of you. Gain the name of action inside of you. Connect to yourself. Know yourself. Be. And action will be yours. It will act through you in your life if you will simply be. Recognize the native hue of resolution. Brave the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune. Suffer them. Let conscience not make a coward of you. Rather, immerse yourself in the native hue of resolution, the color of that. Meditate on what it means, the color of resolution, to return to solution, to be dissolved. This essentially is a prescription for meditating on your own death. If you know anything about the Egyptian mystery schools, you will know that Egyptian spirituality and the Egyptian mystery schools entirely focused on the concept of death, not the concept of death, on the eventuality of death, the reality of death. So many New Age people says death doesn't exist, this, that, and the other. Death is real. Death is essential. Death is one of the three factors of evolution and the revolution of the consciousness. Death of the ego and the false self, birth of the human soul, and sacrifice for humanity. These are the three factors. Death is very real. Death is required for resolution. Your physical body must dissolve. Ashes to ashes, dust to dust. So must your personality. Sooner, quicker, if you have yourself cremated. But in order for us to awaken, in order for us to achieve enlightenment, our ego must likewise be dissolved. Because it is inside the density of that ego that our consciousness is trapped, that our essence is trapped. But essence is released when you dissolve something. We could go on and on and on, probably for hours, for days, maybe even longer, on this one passage. The most quoted lines that Shakespeare ever wrote, who was an esotericist. Hopefully now you're beginning to see why this is the most important passage ever written in English. It's the whole path. It's the whole work. Everything is in here. Everything you need to know about your spiritual awakening and the path to enlightenment is encoded in this single speech by a character whose worldly name is the inverse of willpower, the motto of Gnostics, the motto of Gnosis, the body which is the human soul, essentially, Tipereth, the causal plane, the causal body, it is the human soul. So Hamlet, in his physical form, and all of his suffering and all of his actions and everything are in many ways the opposite of a human soul. And that's the whole point, why it's a tragedy. And here he is ruminating in the speech over to be or not to be that human soul. Should he reverse his path? Should he reverse his decisions and his actions and his behaviors and thus awaken in Tipereth, awaken in Telema, which is Hamlet backwards? The reverse, the opposite of Hamlet. With that knowledge, you can go back and recognize that all other psychological evaluations about Hamlet and his character are incorrect. They're just window dressing. They're avoiding the essential, fundamental, spiritual, esoteric question at hand here. This passage is not simply about physical death and existence. It is about existence of the soul, the being, and our capacity to know that and live such that the name of that action can come and keep the enterprises of great pith in the moment and be in the current of that, the way that current needs to flow, rather than sickling over it with the pale cast of thought and causing those currents to go awry. It's all there. How many thousands of pages have been written by countless individuals about spiritual awakening and advancement, and it's right here. It's all right here. The fundamental core of spirituality. And it's not the soliloquy. It's practically in six words. To be or not to be. That is the question. It's practically in that single line. What follows is really an elaboration already. To be your being or not to be your being. To be or not to be. This is the spiritual question. Are you your being or aren't you? Do you know his thoughts? Do you know his will? Do you act moment by moment his will? Do you surrender to his will? Or don't you? That's it. And if you do, wonderful. And if you don't, welcome to the plight of suffering humanity. That is the single reason why humanity is the way it is. Simply because we do not comprehend what a human being is. We really don't know what a human being is. Because we don't really know our own innermost being. We don't know how to be. We take arms against the sea of troubles and oppose them instead of suffering the slings and arrows of outrageous fortune with courage, with honor, by being and allowing the name of action to guide us in those enterprises of great pith. There is no other passage in English ever written, ever, that as succinctly and as clearly to the consciousness reveals the path, reveals the way to be free of suffering. We free ourselves from suffering when we no longer oppose it. We free ourselves from suffering when we embrace our innermost. When we find telema within ourselves and we cultivate that willpower. The will to be, to simply be. The will to surrender to our true self. The most important words ever written in English. They describe clearly and concisely to our consciousness, to us, if we read them with our heart, the most important task we need to do day by day, moment by moment, if we hope to advance in our life, spiritually speaking, if we hope to achieve oneness with ourselves and all beings, and if we hope to contribute towards the end of suffering of all beings. And that is why, to be or not to be, that is why that is the question. The question of questions. So by now, we hope you recognize this is not a matter of subjectivity. This is not a matter of subjective opinion. Those are the most important words ever written in English because that is the most important question in our life. Am I or am I not connected with the name of action within me? Am I or am I not in line with those currents which are trying to flow through my life into the world? Or am I trying to take arms against a sea of troubles and am I trying to oppose them? Am I asleep? Or am I dying, consciously dying to that sleep? Truly, we must give pause in our own lives, just as Hamlet did in this speech, and ask ourselves these questions. Thanks for listening. We'll see you again soon.